I like to discuss infrared photography. People frequently ask me, can you shoot infrared in the winter? Do I need to wait until spring to shoot infrared? Absolutely not. There are lots of subjects you can shoot in the winter, maybe the most obvious being fir trees. You could shoot architecture. You can focus on monochrome images. You could shoot people. You can also shoot artificial light. Last winter, I did a review of an infrared filter shooting only snowy winter scenes. Check out that video to see snow in infrared. In this video, I'd like to talk about shooting artificial lights in infrared and four different methods for processing these images. Are you interested in learning more about infrared photography? Check out my book, Color Doesn't Exist, A Practical Guide to Infrared Photography. It's full of details for photographers at all skill levels. A link is in the description. The first method that I'd like to discuss is monochrome processing with color grading. So one of the things that we look for in infrared when we're shooting artificial light is sort of the nature of the light, and is it more monotone, is it duotone? So let me give you an example of what I mean by that. If I hold down or tap the backspace key, it'll show me the before version of this image. So this is the version with just the infrared temp negative 100 profile. And as you can see in this image, I'm getting kind of two tones of light. I'm getting some predominantly yellow light we're seeing in the reflections here and we're seeing in the towers, but I'm also seeing a slightly different tone of light under the bridges. So it's a little bit orange here, you can see in these spaces under the bridges. So one of the things that I'll do is decide, is an image going to give me enough interest in those two tones, or do I want to stick with a single monochrome tone? So in this case, we went with a monochrome tone. So if I switch back to the final version, you can see here that I converted this image to monochrome, and I did that using a black and white profile. So if I open up the profile browser here, and if I go down to the B&W group, these are the black and white profiles that ship with Lightroom. You could have the same black and white profiles with other editors, or you could, you know, use something like SilverFX Pro to convert to black and white as well. Any of those would work fine. But in this case, I simply picked a profile. You could see the different profiles and how they would treat the image. I picked the one that was the best for this image. And then the other thing that I did is I applied a color grade. So if we go into color grading, and I'll go to the three-way view so you can see the three different levels. So in the shadows, I applied a blue color. In the highlights, I applied an orange color, which was the complement of the blue. And then in the midtones, I applied a little bit of magenta. So that gives me the look of this image. So if the lights that you're shooting, the artificial lights, are somewhat uniform in source and produce a single color, you can edit as is, or you can convert to monochrome. Let's look at another image in this set. So this image taken in the same shoot, this one I think more shows the single source of light. So in this case, you've got a predominant yellow color in this light. There's a little bit of blue in some of the lights in the distance, but it's not enough to create a contrast. And so going with the monochrome processing is definitely the way to go for this image. Now here's an image that strictly speaking wasn't converted to monochrome, but it contains artificial lights that are all of the same color temperature. So if I was to look at this image, so I've got an infrared temp of negative 50 to get a good white balance. And if I just grab my white balance picker and I pick this tree over here, it's going to give me a pure white look on this tree, which is okay. And maybe if I convert this to monochrome, I might like the look of that. But for me, it was a little bit drab. So one of the things that I can do is I can adjust the white balance to change the color. So if I go over to my temp slider, you can see I've got a white balance of about 8,300. If I drag this over to the blue, it's going to give me more of a blue tone in the image. And because of the, you know, snowy, wintry feel that I want, this will give me a better look that I think works better for this image. So this is a case where there is definitely a correct white balance that you can get using the eyedropper, but you can slide this to get various looks if you wanted a warmer look or if you wanted a cooler look, simply by adjusting the white balance. This works well with images that have a single light source. Now let's talk about the second method of processing images with artificial light, and this will be the rest of these methods will all involve full color. And many of these involve this nature of capturing multiple tones of light depending on the source of the light. And so in this case, I'm going to show you what it looks like to process an image simply using one of the infrared temp profiles that will give you a good white balance without doing any color swapping or any other changes. Now, this particular image, this actually is pretty close to this as shot. Let me reset this so you can see what this looks like before I made any changes. So this is the original as shot with simply the infrared temp applied to it. And really, to start with this, the main thing I did was white balance. You've got some gray tones in the road and in this pillar. And there, now you could see the kind of color look that exists in the final image. But of course, it's not quite as amped up as the colors in the final image. But you could see that overall, this is pretty close. I had to do some straightening and a few other things. Let's go back to the final image and talk about some of the changes that I made. So in addition to a number of changes in the basic panel, the other major change that I made here is in the HSL tab, where I've cranked up the saturation on the yellows and have slightly reduced the luminance of the yellows to give those a little bit more pop. The other thing that I did is the blues, because the blues are mostly in the shadows and were very strong, I went and created a mask that is a luminance range mask. So I'm only attacking the darkest parts of the image. If I show overlay, you can see that this mask is predominantly affecting the dark parts of the image. And then from here, I reduce the saturation just so that those blues weren't, they were kind of in your face. I'll show you what this looks like without the mask on. Might be hard to tell on video, but the blues are just really, really overly rich. That wouldn't convert well to a JPEG and certainly wouldn't print well. So I wanted to reduce the saturation on those, and creating the mask allowed me to do that. So this image, with all of these artificial lights happening, and of course you get the streaks from the long exposure from traffic going by and a bus going by, this was most of this was captured in camera with only a few minor tweaks made to get this final look. Here's another image from that same shoot with the same technique applied to it. So you can see we have the infrared temp 100, and we've got a couple different tones going on. So predominantly this yellow tone in the image for these lights, but also some of these street lights are creating these interesting blue flares that only appear in infrared. So that was kind of a cool effect that I really like. Pretty much just looking at this two-tone view, simply shooting in infrared, and this would be with a 590 nanometer filter to capture a little bit of visible light and then infrared light, using infrared temp to set a white balance, and then this gives us these interesting two tones of color. So let's move on to our next technique for adjusting artificial lights, and this is using the hue shift between the blue in the leaves and this, which is light being produced by the lights on the tree and lighting the leaves, and then a different light lighting the background. Let's play with this and try some different colors. So the first thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to go up to the navigator panel here, and I'm going to reduce the size of the image so I can see the whole image and I've got some space around it. Next thing I'll do is go over to the mask, and I want to create a linear gradient. So I'm going to hold down the shift key, and I'm going to start outside of the image, and I'm going to drag away from the image. And this will have the effect of producing a mask across the entire image. So now any change that I make to the image will affect the entire image. Let me turn off the overlay because we know this is all part of it. And I'll go back to fit so I can see this full screen. Now I can come down here in my mask settings, and I can go to the hue box, and I can drag this around to see what the looks will be. So if I go to about 30 degrees, now I've got this purple and yellow look. If I go to about 60 degrees, I'm just dragging roughly here, I've got an interesting purple and green look. For about every 30 degrees, you'll see a dramatic difference in the view. So at about 90 degrees, now I have this green and magenta look. At 120 degrees, similar with just more intense colors. At about 150 degrees, I've got a cyan background and a pink foreground. And then at 180 degrees, which would be, you know, typical full color swap you'd do with the hue, you've got a blue background and this sort of orange salmonish color on the trees. So a whole variety. And instead of just simply color swapping, you can choose any of these color combinations to produce some interesting effects. And you could go into the negatives as well, so to produce different colors. And so we'll We'll cycle through some of those. When you have one of these infrared images, again, shot with a 590 nanometer filter with multiple light sources producing two different color temperatures, you can use this hue effect to assign just a whole variety of colors to these two different light sources, creating a variety of interesting effects depending on the image you have and the mood that you want to set. Lots of really interesting options there. I really like this. And finally, our fourth method is basically the traditional color swap. So we can apply one of the color swaps that we would normally do for an infrared image. So that could be a hue shift, 180, kind of like we just did. Could be an invert, or it could be a channel mixer with a red-blue swap, or maybe making some changes to the green channel as well. So let me give you an example. This particular image, if I go back to the infrared temp 100, this is what it would look like. So I've set the white balance on the snow at the bottom of the tree. I've got this nice blue-white color in this tree itself, but I've also got this interesting yellow color that's happening because the light source coming from within that store is a different color temperature than the light source on the tree. Now that I've done that, I can go into my profile browser. I can use my color swap profiles. You could create your own color swap profiles. You can also do this in Photoshop as well. You could make these changes in Photoshop and apply. I've got a series of Photoshop actions you can download for free to apply these same looks to your infrared images. I've got these two-tone lights going on. I can try the different looks. So this is what a 180-degree hue shift would look like. That blue's a little bit overwhelming in the background. Here is the invert type. So the blue's a little bit more subdued. So this is not so bad. This is a channel mixer red-blue swap. So you've got this teal lights in the background and more orange on the tree. If we were to take a red-blue swap and shift the greens to blue, again, that's a little bit overwhelming on the blues. If we shift to red, this is the one I really like because it gives me this holiday vibe with the green and the red. And then, of course, if you were to do a red-blue swap in the channel mixer and split the greens to the other channels, this is the look that you'd get. Not bad, but again, I still like this look due to the holiday colors. And really, that's it. There's no other really dramatic changes. You know, you could go in and make some basic changes, maybe do some tone curve and some other changes. But what's really nice about these two-tone images is that you can pick the colors that you like for the mood you like, and it's that easy. Here's another image that uses that same style. The lights in this model, you can see that there's two different kinds of lights that are lighting the interior of this model. So one light produces this more orangish color, and then another light produces this blue color. And of course, this is after I've made all of my changes. So this is using the negative 100 temp and simply a channel mixer red-blue swap. If I was to go back to the original version, it would look like this, basically swap those colors around by applying the red-blue version. I really like the look of that. So that gets me this color look. Again, just taking advantage of the fact that there are two different light sources happening with these models to give me a couple different looks, give me this sort of duotone almost style look. And finally, here's an exterior view where we've got this greenhouse with the foliage inside in the larger house in the background being lit by one color of light. And then in the foreground, we have these foreground houses being lit with a different color of light. So it produces this sort of two-tone effect. If I was to go in, I could see all of the different choices that I would have available depending upon what the mood was that I was looking for in this image. So a bunch of different color combinations that are kind of interesting. But again, for the holidays, I like this red and green look. What subjects do you like to shoot in infrared during the dark and snowy season? Let us know in the comments. If you find these videos helpful on your infrared photography journey, please consider liking, subscribing, or leaving a comment. Do you have any topics related to infrared photography that you'd like to see addressed? Leave a comment below. Hope you enjoyed. Thanks.